don't need to introduce you to this guy probably, but if you're new, you might not know this, Elder S.T. Lewis from the Columbus area. And he has been a very, very good brother to us and a brother of our truth, and we want to welcome him to our pulpit.
Thank you very much, Elder Stump. It's always good to be here and to associate in fellowship with people of like precious faith.
Amen.
You know, you always get a little twinge when you hear you go somewhere other than the mainstream stuff. And I've learned that the mainstream stuff is not where Jesus is.
Oh, yeah.
So I'm going to attempt this evening to paint you a picture. And it's really an experience that I had. So I'm going to paint you a picture that's almost like a testimony. And hopefully you can learn some things that the Lord showed me. Let us just bow our heads for a word of prayer. Father, we thank thee for another opportunity to express thy word and to read from your holy word. Lord, we need you as never before. We're sorry for not listening to you and obeying you. And we ask as we give this presentation that someone might see you, understand you, and follow you. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Now, you know, I had a stroke several years ago, and I told you that last time. And that was an experience that I never had. And it tells me that many times, a lot of us, and most of us, some of us, need an experience like that brother gave just a while ago with the, you know, all he had. And sometimes we can't get what the Lord wants us to have without an experience. You know, why in the world did God have to let Jonah go down in the belly of the fish for him to see and understand? He had to have that. Why did the Lord have to knock Paul off of his horse for him to think and understand? And that was the way with me. The Lord had to lay, just put me on a light stroke, said, I just sit down, stop, listen now, and let me talk to you from my word. And so I'm going to share with you some of the things that the Lord has shared. Now, laying in my bed at night, I got to thinking, I said, listen, I've been preaching for 50 years, and I've been telling the folks, do this, do that, don't do this, don't do that. They forget what I say, and you go through the whole thing again. A lot of times, people are discouraged. And they say, you know, I've been doing this all along, and I don't understand what I'm doing. I'm tired of doing it. I can't do it. And I'm just frustrated, so I'm just going to give up. Baptized people many times, and they say, well, you know, they do this, and they hurt me so bad, I'm just going to leave. I don't know what to do. And that's the way the thing goes, 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 goes. So the Lord has shown me in a picture type way what I'm going to share with you. All right? Yeah. Now, in the beginning, God made man. And man was in the garden. Man loved the Lord. The Lord loved him. Satan comes in and he brought death in here. Everybody died. So the Lord said, no, I want you back. I really want you back. You messed up. Amen. And the wages that you have put out brings that death. But before man was here, God had a plan from the foundation of the world that if man messes up, somebody somewhere has to go and redeem him. Amen. Jesus comes forth. And he says that in the event, I'll go down and I'll do what I need to do for man. So God, in his wisdom, found Abraham. And when you read the story of Abraham, you know, I don't read the Bible like I used to read it.
No.
You know, you read it and you hear the story, and you read it, the story it sticks in your head and all like that. But in reading Abraham, Abraham was called the father of the faithful. And I've learned that that's what's uppermost and important with God is faithfulness.
Yes.
And obedience and trust in him. That's ultimate.
Amen.
Now, Abraham had that type of faith. For a man to hear and understand God, and he gets up and he goes 500 miles on foot to where he didn't know where in the world he was going to, took all of his camels, all of his family, and just left. Now the faith that that man had in the word of God supersedes anybody else the Bible recovers on earth. Now that's amazing. Now it didn't stick in my head like that until lately. And because of his faith, God said, I'm going to make you a great nation. He makes him a great nation, and bless your soul, it was like the sand of the sea after all of the mistakes that he made.
Oh.
You see, you forget about the mistakes that he made, just like the mistakes we made, but in God's mercy, he forgave him, and Abraham had this great nation. This great nation goes down into Egypt, and that's where it is for 400 years. And God in his mercy raised up Moses. I got to have my people back. I want my people back. So God raised up Moses to lead them out. He said, look now, I have to lay out before them how they messed up and what they need to do to get back with me. So God lays out his law. He gives them the law, and the law had to do with love for him and love for man. So in your head, because Lucifer has framed it, when you think about law, what do you think about?
Punishment.
Huh?
Punishment.
Yeah, you think about punishment, but when you think about the law, what do you think about the law?
What you can't
Ten Commandments. That's the way I framed it. But the law in terms of the Jew was the first five books of the Bible. It was the Torah. It was the Pentateuch. And God instructed Moses to give them this now to get back in line with me, because if straight away I want them back. And they can't be back with disobedience and no trust. So I'm going to give you this law now because I want you back. And I want you to go by the law. And the law is going to bring you to me and to others so you can be back in relationship with me. And Moses gave them the law. But they always didn't see it. Just like you and me. See, now I'm really talking about myself, but I'm talking about you too. Now you watch this now. Watch it. You know, it's something. Now, God gave them the law. And they said, all right, we're going to do what he said to. And in so doing, they couldn't do it. So the Lord said, listen, I love the whole world. I love the whole world. Now, we think the Lord only loves certain people because they are Christians, because they're Adventists, because they're whatever it is, the whole world. So Jesus loved the whole world. And he says, look, now, I want the whole world back. But my law has to be kept in order to keep them out of my hair. They're against me. They hate me. They don't obey me. So when you read the Old Testament, that's God telling man what they did, how they did it, and what they got to do to get back in relationship with him. Isaiah just read, wrote all about it. You strayed from me. You left me alone. You leave me behind. You mistreat people. You're unkind. I'm going to send you a Messiah, and he's going to redeem you back. And they read all that, and they still strayed away. Sent Jeremiah. Oh, they didn't like Jeremiah. They said, listen, we hear what you're saying. We're God's people, and we don't going to do what we want to do. We're going to put you in the dungeon because Nebuchadnezzar ain't going to come and take us. We're going to be here, and we're sick of you telling us straighten up and be right. It looked like we do. Always act somebody. You know, always saying something. Always got something going on. You don't like what you hear. Mad. God in his mercy let them go into captivity. See, they didn't like it. You don't like it. God in his mercy, he's always merciful. See, Satan has come to the earth and has framed how you think about God. See, Satan did that. And he's done that through institutions. See, he's framed how you think. and he framed you thinking against what God says. Amen. See, that's what Satan does. And we follow right down his line. Now let me read you something, how God is. If you got your Bible, just follow along with me all through here, because I got a lot of text to read to you. Exodus 32, 34, verse 5 and 6. I'm going to read a lot of text to you and explain them how the Lord gave me. And the Lord God passed by before him and proclaimed, the Lord God, merciful and gracious and long-suffering and abundant in goodness and truth. Does that sound like God to you? Man, you done heard all kind of stuff about God. He ain't this, he ain't that, he ain't the other. Keeping mercy for thousands, forgiving iniquity and transgression and sin, and that will by no means clear the guilty, visiting the iniquity of the fathers unto the children, and to the children's children unto the third and the fourth generation. Now that's how God described himself in the Old Testament. Okay? He's merciful. He's gracious. He's kind. He's loving. He's long-suffering. Not willing that anybody should perish. Even though in your head, you say, oh God, he's mean. He's hateful. That's where the Satan comes in. He's hateful. He doesn't like us. He wants to kill us. He wants to save us. He wants to save us because he's God. Now, in wanting to save us, before we knew anything, Paul tells us that the Lord did something else. Let's go to Ephesians. He gives us a gift. What did he give us? Ephesians. And you've heard all these texts before, just like me and everybody else. Ephesians 2. Lord gives us a gift. Ephesians 2 and verse 8. For by grace are ye saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is a gift of God. So here we're lost now. We need saving. And what do you do to get saved? You believe. Now, where does belief take place at?
In the mind.
In your head. See? He gives you this gift, and if you believe in your head, you get it. But what are you, what have I been teaching folks? You got to do something.
Mm.
You got to go here. You got to go there. You got to join something. Join the Adventist church. This brother stood up and said, you talk about joining you and all the churches joining church. You got to join. The Bible says the gift of eternal life is a gift. Now, a gift is something that somebody gives you that you don't earn.
Amen.
Paul says we've earned death. And so we're supposed to die, but Jesus comes along and gives us a gift. But now, we as ministers talk about working to get it.
Mm-hmm.
Huh?
Mm-hmm.
Got to do this. Got to do that. Got to keep the commandments. Got to do this. All this other stuff you got to do. And people get tired of that. So Jesus now, he is promised to come. Now the priests were telling the people that when Jesus comes, he's going to set up his kingdom so that they can be kingdom rulers again in Israel. Just like you and I think we're sick of this old world and we have to do something to bring Jesus back because we're tired of the sin. Don't you think like that? So you got to work and do something. And watch this now. Jesus in his mercy, when the time was right, the Bible says he comes into the world. Jesus, the Son of God. But because the priest had told the people when he's going to come in, he's going to come in like a king, they were looking for him to come like he came. even though 500 years ago, before he showed up, through Daniel and the other prophets, they said when he was going to come, how he was going to come, the town he was going to be born in, and all that information went right over their heads. Just like the things that's in the scriptures goes over your head. I'm going to show you how it goes over that in a minute. See, you read it, you hear it, well, you know, I don't know nothing about that. The priest back there saying he's going to come to be a king, be a king. So when he comes there, we're going to make sure we're going to get the right seats beside him. So they tell you he's coming like a king. So they didn't read what the scripture said on how he was going to come. Born in Bethlehem, in a town, exactly right on time when the fullness of time he showed up. And one of the big reasons why he came, along with the reason why he died, is because he came to fulfill the law that Moses had given him to keep him in line with the Lord. Fulfill is one of the most important words in Hebrew and Greek. It means to make visible so it can be seen. Jesus Christ came in, one of the reasons to come into the world, so that man could see how God was. Because we're so into seeing stuff, touching stuff, involving stuff. So Jesus comes into the world so the law can be seen, fulfilled. He comes into the world. Here he is now. Comes in like a baby. Well, that wasn't him, they think. Grows up. Didn't go to the school. That really kind of bugged him. It's like, you know, you got to go to the academy. Got to go to Andrews. Got to go to Columbia Union. Got to go there. Jesus didn't go to this school. But he fooled all of the preachers in the church, in the synagogue. Stunned them. Didn't know how to take it. And the reason why they didn't believe what the prophecies had said about him. Just like we today, the prophecies have been given to us things. We don't get it. We don't believe it. Now, I'm going to hit you right in the head in a minute. Now listen. The whole point is the law of God is here. Jesus came and fulfilled that law. He says, all right, you got to fulfill the law. I want you to see it. I want you to see how my Father is. He's loving. He's gracious. He's kind. He's long-suffering. And in so doing, I'm trying to show you the most important thing that he's interested in, and that's the belief that you have in your head about who he is.
Amen.
That's what I want you to get, the belief, the trust, the loyalty, the obedience. Now that's what's most important to him. But to man, most important thing is to do something. You know, go to church, pass out handbills, go do this, do that. Equating all that doing to where it will give you eternal life. But Jesus said it was a gift. So if it's a gift, you can't get it like that. It comes because of your faith. So he spends 33 and a half years on this earth trying to show us and them the most important things into being saved and redeemed. He showed faith every time you turn around. You got to have faith. They were in a boat. The storm came up. So he said, where is your faith at? Faith was right there with him. But they didn't see him. They looking right at him and didn't see him. The man got sick. And so the centurion comes over, brings his entourage. My son is sick. Oh, he's at the point of death. Oh, listen, can you just please come by and see him? And Jesus said, listen, don't worry about it. He's already well. And just as soon as he said that, they said back home, he got well. Now that's trying to show his disciples that the most important thing was to believe. to believe in him who he has sent. And amazingly, we as human beings don't get it. We just don't get it. We're constantly worrying about this, that, and the other. Now it comes time now for Jesus to die. And he's getting ready to die. Now he's worked. He done sent him the prophets. He done gave him the law. He done come himself. And they just still don't get the gift that he's trying to give them. Just like us. We just don't get it. Now, I talk about myself. I'm concerned about the dude. And as I prepared this little remark, I thought about Sister Ann back there. And I thought about Sister Cox in my church. About people who are sincere and we're getting in years to where we want to make this thing right. You wonder, am I going to make it? What's going to happen? But if you just go to Jesus, he made it all right.
Amen.
See, Jesus is what the world needs. And I'm not saying that as a cliche. I'm telling you that as a fact. Now, I'm going to read some of the scriptures to you that Jesus said. Now, listen. Go, if you will, to John 14. John 14. Now, this is Jesus talking. I know you're familiar text. We've been quoted it 100 times. Let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. That's Jesus talking now. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. Now he's telling them all this because he's getting ready to die. And then after a while, he's getting ready to go back to his Father. He's been here 30-something years. And it looked like no matter what he says or what he does, his disciples that follow him wasn't getting it. Just like we don't get it. Oh, I've been in the church for 20 years. Oh, I've been following the Lord for 50 years. We don't get it. See, there's no substitute for taking this Bible and sitting down quietly and prayerfully and letting the Holy Spirit tell you what Jesus is telling you. Not me as a preacher, but you. See, we're too used to letting somebody else spoon feed you the gospel. See, that's all right, but you need to see it for yourself. And when you read it for yourself, the Holy Spirit talks to your head. See, now that's what's missing. Now watch now. Now there's three guys here he's talking to. The three disciples. I'm going to read you what these three guys did. Verse 5. Thomas said unto the Lord, who was Thomas? He, huh?
Doubting.
All right, but who was he though?
Disciple.
He was a, that's right, he was a disciple. He was a follower. Now who are you?
Follower.
I thought you were going to say you was a member. that was you, I'm a member of so-and-so, I'm a member. Now he ain't said nothing about no member. They were disciples. They were followers of Jesus that looked at him, watched him, saw him, ate with him, saw the miracles that he wrought, and did all that. But even seeing that with their eyes, there was still something missing. Just like you. You can sit there and read that Bible. You can go to church every Sabbath day, and there's something missing. You don't get it. See, now listen. Thomas said unto him, Lord, we know not whether thou goest, and how can we know the way? Now, they've been following Jesus for 30 years. Now, he worrying about what way should go. So you've been going to church for 30 years, and you ain't been looking at Jesus. You've been looking at the preacher, the deacons, the members, somebody, but you don't know which way to go. If you're sitting there worried, and hoping and praying and said, Lord, what do I need to do? What do I need to do? He said, which way do we go? Jesus said unto him, I am the way. Me, not the church, not the organization, but him. Now that's got through my head. See, where do you belong? I belong to Jesus. Who are you following? You mean to tell me you don't follow what the general? No, I'm following Jesus. See, I am the way. Jesus said he is the way.
Amen.
So if I want to walk or live or die, whatever it is, I want to follow Jesus. I am the truth. There's no falsehood in him.
Amen.
I am the truth. No man coming to the Father except by me. I don't want to go to heaven. So if you're going to heaven, you got to follow him. Now the devil has framed it where he wants you to follow an order. An order or a, can you call it a denomination? You got to belong to a denomination. Are you still out there? And ask me, my you, where should I go? What denomination should I belong? See? And bless his heart, stump. He ain't worried about that. See, that's what makes him so such a great guy. He worried about following Jesus. See, and oh, he gets criticized. Oh, you done left the church. Oh, you're doing this. Man, he's following Jesus.
Amen.
I am the way, the truth, and the life. The life that you have, Jesus gave it to you. The breath that you breathe, he gives it to you. He started it when you was a child. So he is all in all. He is the way, he is the truth, and he is the life. Jesus. You want to live? Follow Jesus. And then another brother. Philip said unto him, now these are the guys that follow him. Philip said, Lord, show us the Father, and it satisfies us.
Hmm.
Now this man had been looking at Jesus for 33 years. Didn't he know who he was? Just like us. Been reading about him for 50 years. Didn't know who he was. Talking about him 50 years. Hadn't seen him. Listen. That I say and call ourselves disciples. Now this brother was right in his presence and couldn't see him. Now what do you think about us? See, that's how slick the devil is. If you don't know Jesus, he will fool you. Now hold it now. Remember now, Jesus is on his way out. He's dying. He's on his way to the cross. He's given them the scriptures. He sent them the angels. He gave them the prophets. And here he is, the last stretch. His disciples asking about who he is. I know that must have made him so sad. So sad. His disciples want to know who the Father was. And he is him showing who the Father was. In his kindness, in his mercy, in his justice, in his long sufferings, how he treated people, how he cared for people, how he loved people. And they just looking at him, who are you? Now to guarantee that they really understand what it will take to be saved, Jesus wanted to guarantee us salvation. Guarantee it. He didn't leave it to chance now because he's on his way out. He wanted to guarantee it. Because I tell you what, since in so many words they didn't get it, he said, I'm going to tell you what I'm going to do. That now verse 10. Believest thou not that I am in the Father, and the Father in me? words that I speak unto you, I speak not of myself, but the Father that dwelleth in me. He doeth the works. So since you can't get a grasp on who the Father is, you believe in him because of the works that you see me do. Since you can't get a grasp on it now, you saw me heal, you saw me raise the dead, you saw all that, so you believe in me because of what you saw me do. Since you can't understand who the Father is. Verse 11. Believe me that I am in the Father, and the Father in me. Or else believe me for the works' sake. Now, he's on earth. Father's in heaven. But he says, he's in the Father, and the Father's in him. That's pretty good, isn't it? He's up there. Father's up there, and Son down here. I'm in him. He's in me. That's good. Wait a minute now. His way makes him feel good at. Verse 14. If ye ask anything in my name, I will do it. And if ye love me, keep my commandments. And I will pray the Father, and he will give you another comforter that he may abide with you forever. He said, now wait a minute. I'm going to ask the Father to give you something that you need. A helper. Something that you need. Now he done taught you everything. Everything you need to know when he was here on this earth, he taught you. Taught you how to love. Taught you how to get along with people. Taught you how to keep his commandments. Taught you what to do when you get ready to get married. Taught you what everything. He taught it. He said, I'm leaving now. I'm showing you the law, and it appears that you can't keep it. But I'm going to ask the Father to send you something to help you keep that law. And I want you to put it in your head. Now that's pretty good. Because your head is the seat of activity. You can't do it by yourself. So I'm going to come and live in you. And that's literal. Now when I used to read that, it just slid right over my head. Going to live in you. The Spirit comes from the Father to Jesus to live in me. Hold on now. I'm going to read 16 again. And I will pray the Father, and he will give you another comforter that he may abide with you forever. As long as we are here, Jesus has promised to send me a helper. What for? To make sure that I go to heaven. I need help. You can't go by yourself. You ain't even got sense enough to accept the gift. So he's going to put it in your head so that you won't violate his law. So you won't be out of step with him. Amen. Boy, that's pretty good. That's a guarantee. Hold on, I ain't through. Even the Spirit of truth. Truth? No error. Amen. Jesus gives you the Spirit in your head of what truth is. So you don't have to wonder around. Well, I got to check this, or I got to check that. Well, I need all, I don't know what's truth. I don't know what it is. Because the devil done framed everything over here to make sure you never get to this. He framed it to make sure you never know what the Trinity is. I had a good friend, I gave him one of the books explain this Trinity thing. And he goes, and I guess he reads it, and he yells, at, oh, you don't believe in the Trinity, do you? I said, do you believe in Sunday? No, Sunday ain't in the Bible. I said, the Trinity ain't either. But see, he's been framed to accept Trinity. See, not understanding the Godhead. That's how the devil is. To take the truth and frame it the way he wants you to think it, and the whole world follows that. Whole world follows that, including Adventists. Hold it now. Verse 17, even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it seeth him not, neither knoweth him. But ye know him, for he dwelleth with you, and shall be in you. Do you grasp that? Can you get your head around that? This Spirit that Jesus sent to us comes from the Father. And he said, listen, I'm going to put it in you if you accept it. Now, you got to accept it. And he said, it's in your mind. And it's a choice that you make between what the Spirit tells you and what your flesh tells you. Satan controls your flesh. He makes it big. He makes it strong. He makes it beautiful. But you can't see the Spirit, because the Spirit dwells in your head. He told Nicodemus, you got to be converted. You have to convert. In other words, stop listening to your flesh and change and listen to the Spirit.
Amen.
It's a choice you got to make.
Amen.
Now when you make that choice, he comes right there. And he says, I'm going to help you. I'm going to live in you to help you make sure that you are redeemed. He gives you the illustration of the vine and the branches. He says, you can't do nothing without me.
That's right.
Nothing. Now, yeah, I'm thinking I'm doing something by preaching. I ain't doing nothing. Well, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to run a tent meet. Every year, run a tent meet. I'm doing that. Not literally thinking that's going to give me salvation, but that's what they make you think. Baptizing people, making them think that if you join the Adventist church, that's your salvation.
Mm-hmm.
Have you ever heard that?
Yes.
And unconsciously, that's the way people think. If I just get in the church, I got salvation, and leave Jesus out altogether. It never is explained to anybody generally how you can receive the Holy Spirit to live within you. And I used to get frustrated with all the lessons that we used to have. Lessons on this, lessons on that, lessons on the other. And none of them explaining what Jesus was trying to get through them folks' mind. Living by the Holy Spirit. I'm not through. Verse 18. And I will not leave you comfortless. I will come unto you. Now, if you're not comfortless, he's there to comfort you. So don't worry. Don't let your heart be troubled. Just let me come into your head and I'll give you some peace. At verse 19. Yet a little while, and the world seeth me no more, but ye see me, because I shall live also. All that day ye shall know that I am in my Father, and ye are in me, and I in you. Pretty simple, isn't it? Can you get your head around that? Jesus gets from his Father his Spirit. Then he turns around and gives it to you and puts it in your head if you can believe it.
Mm-hmm.
And if you listen to what he says in your head, his head will send you to the Word, and the Word and what's in your head will match. And that's a guarantee for salvation.
Amen.
Pretty good. Hold on, I ain't through. He goes to Judas now, verse 22. Not that Judas had killed Christ. Judas said unto him, not Iscariot, Lord, how is it that thou wilt manifest thyself unto us and not unto the world? Why are you telling us this and you ain't telling the world? See, the same questions that the disciples of old asked are the same questions that we ask. People are generally the same. Ain't no difference in us than them. And Jesus, through the word, is telling us, this is the way they did, and this is the way I'm doing. Jesus answered and said unto him, if a man love me, he will keep my words, and my Father will love him, and we will come unto him and make our abode with him. We, who is we?
Father.
The Father and the Son. He said, now the Father and the Son are going to get together and come and live in your head if you just let me. Now that is straight as you can get it.
Amen.
We will come and abide, not outside you, but with you. In everywhere you go, he will go. Anything you need, he will be there. Now, boy, that's just great to me.
Amen.
Now, all the worry and the concern that I got, I ain't thinking about it because Jesus has promised me that.
Amen.
And wait, I ain't through yet. He that loveth me, not keepeth not my word, saying, and the word which ye heard is not mine, but the Father which sent me. These things have I spoken unto you, being yet present with you. I said, I'm telling you now, because I'm telling you while I'm here. And here he goes again. But the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things and bring all things to your remembrance, whatsoever I've said unto you. What remembrance? The things that he taught. He taught you everything you need to know. You can't remember them. And he knows you can't remember them. But whatever you need, what he taught, if you read it in the Word, he'll bring it back to your head when you need it.
Amen.
Now you're going to beat that.
Can't beat that.
Now, he laid the law out, made the law plain, came to the earth, and showed you deliberately in your mind and in your head where it was. And then he says, I'm getting ready to leave now, but to guarantee that I can redeem you, me and my Father want to come and live in you. And when you need me, I'll be there to remind you of the things I taught you.
Amen.
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 Boy, you want to get married. Oh, the person looks good. Something in your head. Don't you marry that. But you don't listen. Or whatever it may be. You want to save up some money. Say, no. You want to dress up real fine. Spend a whole lot of money on clothes. Just listen to the lily. More beautiful than Solomon and all of his stuff. Whatever you need, the Lord has taught and shown you in his word, whatever that might be. You get mad at somebody, I'm going to give him a piece of my mind. What did he do? He wouldn't get mad. Just go over there and turn him the other cheek. They got mad at me. Slap me, spit on me. What did I do? I ain't said nothing. Teach you how to act. Teach you how to love people. Even your enemies. Everything you need to know in order to be saved and in order to God's law, in order to put trust and confidence in him, he provides it in you to make sure that you are redeemed. Reading on now. Verse 27. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give unto you. Not as the world giveth, I give unto you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither be afraid. You need peace. The Holy Spirit with the Father can live in you and give you the peace and satisfaction that worries you after death about whether you're going to heaven or hell. Now that's as good as it can ever get. Now listen, the Holy Spirit comes, he abides in you, he will teach you everything. You can't do nothing without him. He'll testify of Jesus. See, we ain't never seen Jesus with our eyes. But the Holy Spirit will testify that he was here and did what he did. And verse 16 and verse 7. Now let me read you this here. John 15, 26. But when the Comforter is come unto you, I will send unto you from the Father, and even the Spirit of truth, which proceedeth from the Father, he shall testify of me. Who is he going to testify of?
Jesus.
Not the church. Not the elders. Not the deacons. He will testify of me. And ye shall also bear witness, because ye have been with me from the beginning. Now listen to verse 16, verse 1. These things have I spoken unto you, that ye should not be offended or upset. I'm telling you all these things because the world is going to put some pressure on you. Don't be offended. Don't be upset. Don't let that discourage you, because I'm going to abide with you. I'm going to be in you. I'm going to be with you, and I'm going to direct you. They shall put you out of the synagogue. Ooh. Why? Because he is with them. He is in them. And here again, I think about Stump. You got a mixed up name. That's all right. That's not Trump. That's Stump. Stump is like a foundation. Now, when the man finds the truth, the authorities got mad at him and wanted to run him out. They're going to do the same thing to you. The reason why is they want to put pressure on you yet, because they think you're part of them. They shall put you out of the synagogue. Yea, the time cometh that whosoever killeth you will think that he doeth God's service. See, now remember now, he's in you, he's with you, he's going to abide with you, him and his Father in you.
Amen.
Son of, now don't be offended, he said, not because trouble is headed your way. And he knows that when this trouble comes, unless you abide with him and in him, then you'll be able to stand. The trouble is coming. It's on its way. And the first thing you won't decide to do is to save your hide when the pressure comes. And unless the Father and Jesus, the Father and the Spirit is in your head, you'll give up and let go. But Jesus said they're going to run you out. Don't be offended by that. Now listen, what are you going to do? Verse 4. But these things have I told you, that when the time shall come, ye may remember that I told you of them. See, now we're running around and we ain't thinking about nothing. We see this going on. I don't see nothing going on. You're going to remember. I told you what is going to happen now. Verse 5. Verse 6. But because I have said these things unto you, sorrow hath filled your heart. Nevertheless, I tell you the truth. It is expedient or necessary, important for you that I go away. For if I go not away, the Comforter will not come unto you. But if I depart, I will send him unto you. So now I got to get out of here now. I'm telling you before I go. I'm telling you, I'm going to send him back. When he comes back, he's going to be in your head. He's going to be with you. then the Father's going to be there in the spirit. He's going to lead you and guide you into all truth. But I got to go so he can come. And this is what he said. And when he comes, he will reprove the world of sin and of righteousness and of judgment. There's that word. Of sin because they believe not on me. Of righteousness because I go to my Father and you see me no more. Of judgment because the prince of this world is judged. I have yet many things to say unto you, but you cannot bear them. And when he comes, when I get out of here, he's coming back. And he's going to be everywhere. And he'll do the same thing to everybody if you just open your head. See, we have a way of thinking that because you think a certain way, that nobody can tell you nothing. And you get an attitude. I mean, yeah, you do. Oh, he ain't right. If you ain't talking about Jesus, oh, you don't give nothing to me. Oh, he didn't say that. Get an attitude. When the Spirit comes back and is in you, it'll always testify about Jesus. Amen. And he will convict you of sin. You want to go and take a gun and blow somebody's brains out? Something in your head. Which is, don't you do that. Because I don't agree with your word. You want to get mad at somebody and go bless them out? Someone tell you, no, don't do that. Jesus wouldn't do that. Whatever it is, if the Spirit is in you, whenever you go wrong, it'll convict you. Convict to where it makes an impression because the conviction will agree with the word. And the word will agree with Jesus. Isn't that nice? Now how in the world can you beat that? Jesus just wants you to change your attitude. Now listen, I'm through yet. Convict your sin, Romans 8:26. Now this is a real doozy. Romans 8:26. You know it and quote it all the time. But you ain't thinking about it when you quote it. Romans 8:26. Romans 8:26. Likewise, the Spirit also helpeth our infirmity. See, you think you got everything going, know everything. We all have infirmity or afflictions or problems or issues. The Spirit, likewise, helpeth our infirmities. For we know not what we shall pray for as we ought to. Now you pray, I pray. But the Spirit that's within you, if you let him in there, gets with your spirit, and you try to say one thing that your flesh wants. Oh, I want a job. Oh, I want this. I want that. And the Spirit says, no, you don't need that. You know, the Spirit says, no, you, here's what you want right here. Now, that's pretty good, isn't it? Now, that, see, everything that we need, God guarantees it if we accept and believe him. All the way down to the prayers that you pray, that you're thinking, that you're telling him what you need and you want, he knows you don't want what you think you need. Now, isn't that good? Now, man, he wants to save you just that bad. He's in there out here praying, and they want this, and they want that, and the other, but they really want something else. And that's what he said. For ye know not what ye should pray for as you ought, but the Spirit itself maketh intercessions for us with groanings which cannot be uttered. The Spirit makes groanings for us based on your connection with that Spirit. The Spirit tells the Father, he's praying down there, but he don't know what he's praying for. So I know what he needs. So Father, here's what the man needs. Now how in the world are you going to beat that? That's all the process of guaranteeing you your salvation, which is easy and simple. He says, take my yoke upon you and learn of me because it is what?
Easy.
See, we take the devil's thing and make it hard. Mm-hmm. Oh, it's so hard. Oh, I can't do nothing what I want to do. Oh, I can't do this. I can't keep no commandments. I can't keep no law. I can't do whatever. It makes it hard. Why? Because you don't have the indwelling of the Holy Spirit in your head. Jesus wants us so bad. He's made every provision for salvation to be ours if we just accept what he says and get out of our minds the stuff that the devil has put in us that frames how we think about salvation. He wants us to believe that we got to do some work or some kind of something to give us salvation. Now, when he's in you, he says you will have fruit.
Mm-hmm.
Fruit meaning what you can see that comes out. Mm-hmm. Paul said the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long suffering, goodness. Those are the same attributes of God that I just read you in Exodus. That's the fruit. The fruit. Oh, I've been trying to love you all my life. Oh, I've been trying to love. Give us more love. Lord, give us more love. Give us some more joy. Give us some peace of mind. He didn't tell you how to get it. Open your mind by choice and let the Spirit come in and control all that. And what comes out of you will be obedience. It will be love. It will be joy. It will be peace, because he's in you, and that what automatically comes out of you without Amen. You even having to try. An apple tree, you don't have to worry about producing apples. That's what it automatically does.
Amen.
Orange tree, you don't have to worry about, well, should I bring some oranges or should I bring something else out? It automatically brings oranges out.
Amen.
So the Christian who is converted and lets the Spirit live in them automatically brings out the attributes of God.
Amen.
Amen.
Salvation is guaranteed. Hebrews 3. Hebrews 3. Verse 7. Paul understood this because he was converted. Hebrews 3:7. Wherefore, as the Holy Ghost said, today if you hear his voice, Holy Ghost said, listen, the day that you understand what you can do to receive this Spirit, that's the day you respond. Don't put it off. Don't say, I'm going to wait till tomorrow. I'm going to wait till next week. I got to get my job together. The day that you hear it, harden not your heart, as in the provocation in the day of temptation in the wilderness. In other words, don't harden your heart. See, everybody who thinks himself as a Christian, he has an attitude. And you can't tell him nothing. Unless a person agrees with what you say, you don't want to hear it. See, even if a person gives you something you don't want to hear, let the Spirit tell you that he's telling you the truth or not. Now, if you don't have the Spirit, you won't know whether he's telling you the truth or not. Don't harden your heart. See, some people are just hardening their heart about this Trinity thing. They don't want anybody they want to be involved with. Oh, no, we got it right. Don't even know where it came from. They don't even know why they believe what the way they do. See, the average church folks, including Adventists, we don't even know why we do what we do. We go into the church and we sit down and we sing a song. Then you have the order of service. Now, where did the order of service come from? You don't even know. And the amazing thing is, you don't say anything about the sermon, which is supposed to be the heart of the whole gathering, is put down at the end of the whole thing. You don't say nothing about that. You go through the announcements, and you go through the singing, and you go through the testimony, you go through everything, and everything, and by that time you're dead asleep half, or your stomach is turning in your belly, and you're ready to get up, and you got to go to the bathroom, and when the preacher gets up, oh, you ain't ready to hear nothing, you don't hear what he says. Now, I'm telling you, now you know I'm telling you the truth. You don't know where that came from. You don't know where this idea of corporate church come from, that you belong, got to belong to it. When the scriptures through Jesus went to the synagogue. You know what a synagogue is? A synagogue is a gathering or an assembly. So you think it's a building. The devil done told you that. That's what you believe. You think that Jesus went into a building, which he did. But it was an assembly in somebody's house. His brother talking about a house. He's got a house. He said, oh, you don't know a house. No, went into a house. About 12 of them in there, 25 or 50. And he got their scroll. And he began to read from Isaiah about himself. And they talked and they prayed and they sang. Probably took up an offering. And they left. And when they left, they got mad at him. See, that ain't what the church is today. Church is raising money, promoting this, raising building fund, all that other kind of stuff. And the preacher preaches to that. See, all the things that we do that's been framed by the devil to fool you, to keep you away from this point that I tried to bring out to you tonight. But nothing is more important than that Jesus left. Now, when he left, he could have said, listen now, folks, you've got to keep that Sabbath. If you don't keep it like I told you to keep it, you're going to hell. He said, listen, you got to pay that tithe. If you don't pay it like I told you to pay it, you ain't going nowhere. But no, in his mercy, he said, let me come and live in you, and I will tell you exactly what I want when I want it. Amen. When the Sabbath shows up, I will tell you what to do on it, how to live on it. When you get your money, I'll tell you what to do. Let me tell you.
Amen.
But no, you got to let some man tell you. And he done told you in Matthew 24, three times, let no man deceive you, whether it's the preacher man, the elder man, the deacon man, or the pope man. Don't let no man deceive you.
Amen.
And every time you turn around, you talk about somebody that you did this, somebody did this, somebody said that. Tell me what Jesus said. That's all I want to know.
Amen. Amen.
Paul said, I don't want to know nothing except Jesus Christ and him crucified.
Amen. Amen.
Harden not your heart. As in the provocation, in the day of temptation in the wilderness. When your fathers tempted me, proved me, and saw my works 40 years. Wherefore I was grieved with that generation, and said, they do always err in their heart, and they know not my way. Now, Paul gets this from David, telling the people, don't keep messing with God. God brought him out of Egypt, gave him his law, gave him Moses, and they just fooled around, wouldn't believe what he said, doubted what he said for 40 years. Said, don't do God like that. Don't put off what he's trying to get in your head and put it off for tomorrow, next week. Don't mess with him like that. He said, accept him that day. So my appeal to you is, if you don't know the Lord through the Holy Spirit, don't go to bed tonight until you ask him to come and live in you and be with you.
Amen.
Amen.
And when you tell him that, you can't see it. But he comes right there.
Amen.
And he will lead you right to the scripture. And as you read the Bible, he will tell you everything that you need. And when you need it, he'll bring it back to your remembrance.
Yes.
And if you be faithful and follow what he says in his word, he says, I'm the way. If you want to get to the Father, you just follow me. I will take you straight there. Now, I ain't got no better sense than to believe that.
Amen.
So I'm looking by faith to go back to Jesus when he comes, because I took his advice.
Amen.
Now I can confess to you tonight that I've always seen it like that. See, I ain't always seen that. See, and I don't expect you to always see it like that. But if you let the Bible teach you, you'll see what I see.
Amen.
Because the Spirit is the same. The same with you as it with me.
Amen.
And the Spirit is the same with you, me, and this. Jesus doesn't change.
Amen.
So I'm thankful that the Lord has given us a guarantee. And I can rest tonight in peace.
Amen.
And tomorrow, I got a whole lot in my head to tell you. I do. And I'm trying my best to get it told to you in a matter of a few minutes.
Amen.
Now, he done told us this. Now, he gave us the process, the ending process of our salvation in the sanctuary that ends up in these three angels' message. And he asked the Seventh-day Adventist Church in love and in wisdom, would you all please tell the world about these three angels, please? And he gave the outline of the three angels to a little lady named Ellen White. Now, folks don't like it, just like they didn't like Jeremiah, they didn't like Isaiah. They're the same, our heads are the same way. We're God's people, we say. But then he sends us a certain message and we don't want to hear it. It's all out of line. And we're going to come down now to the very end of things, and you don't ever hear nothing about no three angels message. Don't ever hear nothing about it. Why? Because the devil, through the system, has turned your head. And you're looking and watching something else. See, the devil knows how to get people who are interested in Christ by denominationalism. See, he gets you all caught up in that, and you leave off Jesus. And this whole thing about medical missionary work, as he plainly says, this is the way to get people's attention, to help them to learn the truth. The Lord told her to tell us that. But what did we do? We followed man. And man said, what we need to do is to organize and list all of our doctrine. And that's the way to get people to join. So we list all of the doctrine and leave that out. Now, if you're going to list everything, why not leave that? Why not bring the medical mission network into play in terms of what she's saying? We don't listen. Go right over our head. And you miss out. It's sad. We are just like the children of Israel. We're just like the disciples. And we're just like sinful people. We don't get what God is trying to tell us to do. But when we get the Spirit, he will lead us and guide us into all truth and take us to the kingdom of heaven. Father, we thank thee for your word and for the words of Jesus. We ask, O God, in mercy, that you will come and open our heads and give us the Spirit to believe and to accept what you've told us in your holy word. Forgive us, Lord, for overlooking it or ignoring it or go beyond it or go outside of it. Forgive us for that, Lord. We're sorry for doing that. And we promise by your grace We will look at you and what you did and what you told us and how we would let you live within us. We ask it all in Jesus' worthy name and for his sake. Amen. Amen.